Hello, everyone. Thank you for the kind introduction. My name is Akinori Mitani. I studied medicine in Tokyo, and then now I'm working for Google applying machine learning to healthcare. So before talking about deep learning, there are other words, similar words people use almost interchangeably, like artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. So let me explain how we see those words. So artificial intelligence is a system which can do smart things. Like if we can show a picture of either a dog or a cat, and the system can tell whether that's the dog or cat pictures, that's an artificial intelligence. And there are many ways to achieve it. And one way to do it is to build a system which can learn from examples. And we call those machine learning. So in this system, we show thousands of cat images and thousands of dog images. And after that, the system can tell cat and dog apart. And one of the implementation of machine learning is deep learning, which has shown to be very useful and powerful in the last 5 to 6 years, and has been the most, the best performing models in many fields. So what is deep learning? It's an artificial neural network. So it consists of many trainable mathematical units in many layers, and that's why it's called deep. And so if we input a dog image to the system, first it's translated into the activity of those units in the first layer, and then the activity of the units in the first layer is translated to the activity of the second layer, third layer, and finally, in the final layer, those two units, the activity of two units tell whether the original image was a cat or a dog. And the point is the connectivity between those units are trainable. And while it processes thousands of examples during the training phase, they learn how to connect them and learn how to do the task. So this system turned out to be very accurate and very powerful. And the thing is, this learns from the examples. The same structure can be used in many different tasks. We just have to prepare the examples with correct labelings, and the network structure handles the can learn from those examples. So, the idea of the machine learning and deep learning and neural network itself has been around for 50, 60 years. And the reason why it came so popular these days is the development of the hardware. And now we can train a lot more complex models, and we can train with like a lot more examples. At the beginning of the natural intelligence, more handcrafted features. So for example, in ophthalmology, detecting blood vessels and detect like how thick they are, like how what's the curvature of them, and setting some threshold to detect some diseases. Those systems has been around, but the performance has never been on par with human graders. But with the machine learning, with the deep learning system, the performance has getting close to or even better than human graders sometimes. So why we want to apply machine learning to medicine? There is a few characteristics of the field where we want to apply deep learning. So the first, the field has to have a lot of data. It's important for both training, we need the data to begin with, and also the amount of data means there are a lot of room to actually apply the deep learning. And it has been shown that 150 exabytes of data is in the US right now, and it's going to increase even further. And another thing is the expertise is very limited, so we just don't have enough professionals to go through this data. This shows the shortage of radiologists in many areas of the world, and India is not the exception, and ophthalmology also suffers from the same problem. This picture shows a line formed in front of one of our partner hospitals, and people are waiting in line to get their eyes exams. And it's expected that it's reported around 100,000 eye care professionals are insured in India. So we wanted to use deep learning, machine learning to close this gap. The reason why we focus on diabetic retinopathy first is that there are 400 million people with diabetes in the world, and it's expected to increase even further. That means these patients are at risk of developing the DR and eventually become blind. So we wanted to stop that. The one good thing about diabetic retinopathy is that the blindness can be prevented. So this is the fundus image from a healthy individual, and as the disease progresses, there become hemorrhages and their retina develop those symptoms. And ophthalmologists has been classifying the disease progression in multiple classes, and we want to do either refer or do some treatment like anti-VEGF injection or laser coagulation to the patients with developed diseases at the right time. But it needs regular screening, but there are 400 million patients, and how can we screen those patients regularly? So we want to develop a deep learning algorithm to do that. So we first obtained 130,000 images from our partners, and we hired 54 ophthalmologists to grade them, and we get in total 800 diagnoses. And one of the issues is that we ask different doctors, the doctors may give different answers. And there are many ways to come up with a single label, so taking a majority vote between them or going through some education process so they talk with each other and come up with a label. But it's very important that we get a single consistent labeling, both for training and evaluation. And with using those labels, we train a deep convolutional neural network, and the structure of this network is the same as the one we use to classify consumer images like cats, dogs, bikes, cars, and those things called inception model. And this model outputs the class of DR and also the image code D, whether they are gradable or not. And using those our system gets close to or on par with the specialist after several tuning. So when we talk about the performance of the model, the one thing that's really important is we have to really care about the difference between training error and the validation error. So because a system learns from the examples, they tend to perform better with the examples they are trained on. So it's important to have a complete separate data set to evaluate the performance of the model. And even better, if we can fix a model and test with the data collected later, that's a prospective research study, and that's even better. So we are now working with Arvin and Sankara to do the prospective research, and also we are working with several regulatory bodies to make sure we meet their standard so that we know that our model is going to do well in the actual setup. And also we are partnering with hardware companies and like Nikon and various another alphabet company like Google to make the system integrated and a more streamlined process. And to focus a little bit more about the research partners, we are working with Arvind, Sankara, Natriyata, Narayana, Natriyata to do actually deploying those systems to help the patients and also do some further research. One additional thing we found is that those deep learning systems can do something people haven't really thought about because they do see those fundus images a little bit differently from humans. For example, here we showed that from the fundus images, the model can predict the refractive error with great precision. And additionally, we can look at how those models are doing it, and it's looking at the center of the image. And also we looked at what else clinically relevant information we can get. And we looked at the cardiovascular risk factors and age, gender, or HbA1c, we can predict those numbers. And this can be additional information we can get or we can use in the screening setup. So as a summary, artificial intelligence has a potential to improve healthcare through scalable screening. So it increases the patient's accessibility to screening, and each location with a streamlined process can screen more patients. And patients know their grade immediately, and also the greater BT will be available. So that means the technicians can retake the images if necessary instead of going back and forth. And patients can be referred to ophthalmologists without coming back, so there is no dropout during the reference process. And additionally, like the refractive error or cardiovascular risk, those additional information may be provided to them. So through the partnership with the hospitals and everyone, we think we can provide those information, provide those benefits to the patients. Thank you.